of those steps. Let's say our pledges. Remain standing. We'll say our pledge to the Bible first, and then the Christian flag, then the U.S. flag, if it pertains to you. And let's do it. Get your Bibles out. You can put your right hand on it, or you can put your hand over your heart. Maybe you left your Bible on the coat rack out there. Put your hand over your heart, and we can say it. Here we go. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart, that I might not sin against God. Very good. Now the Christian flag representing our Savior.
I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior, for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen and coming again, with life and liberty for all who believe.
Our U.S. flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Amen. I'm so appreciative of that phrase. You may be seated. It's still under God. May not seem it, but guess what? God's in control.
Amen.
He is. He's in control. All right. So, what time is it? Offering time. Xavier and Easton. I asked them to be my ushers today. Would you come on up here? Ushers, today,
thank you.
Take up our offering, our Sunday school offering for Jesus this morning. Let's pray, and then we can take it up to the Lord. Thank you for serving the Lord today, boys. And Lord, we thank you for this day you've given to us and your wisdom, a day set aside just to dedicate solely to you. Lord, we ask that you would be glorified today in this offering. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to learn more about you and to represent you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Brother Dorant Brown with us again, and we love having him, and we're glad that he's able to be with us today. I think you're going to get a blessing as he preaches the word. He's going to be teaching in our Sunday school class, and then he will be singing in the morning service, and so we're so looking forward to that. We're glad he's able to be here. As you know, if you didn't know this already, Janice Alt went home to be with the Lord late Friday night. And her service is here Thursday at 11 a.m. There is a visitation with family Wednesday night. It's over at the formerly Hessel Cheslick. It's now called Northridge Funeral Home. And that's from 7 to 9, just an evening visitation. And then there's an hour of family visitation here from 10 to 11 before the service. And so that's this coming Thursday. So pray for me and pray for the family, as we have that service. We just want to honor her as well as present the gospel. You never know when unsaved people from a family are going to be there. And so be praying for that, if you will. I'm excited about our building because tomorrow they start erecting steel. Pioneers got their equipment. They brought it out Friday. And so that's exciting. Maybe next week when we come, we'll see the building having been stood up, at least parts of it, and that'll be exciting. And so we're thankful for that. Just wanted to encourage you, thank you, and be sure to make Brother Brown feel welcome today while he's here. Pastor Mark?
Right.
He sounds like
all
me.
Right. Any birthdays this last week? We'd love to celebrate it with you, acknowledge your birthday. Nobody's moving for birthdays. How about wedding anniversaries? Any of those last week? wedding anniversaries. We had one last week. It's always something to have one. Had one represented last week. No wedding anniversaries this week. If you had one, you forgot, man. Shame on you. All right. Very good. All right. And we will be going to Sunday school shortly, but first we're going to sing a song. It's a song I always loved singing as a kid, because I love doing this. Fishing. I will make you fishers of men is a song. So let's all stand together. Get out your imaginary fishing poles. Let's fish for some men this morning, all right?
Service Thursday for Janice Alt. Barb Maybe is still in the hospital, so please pray for her and for her continued getting better and better, so keep her in mind. And how many unspokens this morning? I have some urgent unspoken. Yes, we do. We do have several of those. Keep praying for Pastor Richard Yates down in Florida. Our building project is coming along, and we'll be able to see more evidence of that as it goes up. Pray for that. There's an evangelist by the name of Byron Fox. He's on our prayer call on Saturday nights many times. His dear wife, Renee, came very close to death. They were thinking that she was going to succumb to various ills. She has liver disease. She has heart problems. Her body seemed to be shutting down. This morning we got a good report that she came out of a coma. Her name is Renee Fox, and she's responding to questions, and so that's a good signal. So pray for this dear brother's wife, Brother Byron Fox's wife, Renee. We need to pray for Israel. I'll tell you, it's amazing the ramping up of anti-Semitism. Our own country, I think, is starting to turn its back on Israel is very serious. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Our country, there's a lot of turmoil, folks. Just pray. By the way, there is a election guide, a voting guide out there. It doesn't tell you who to vote for. It's how to pray about the election. And there's several copies on the table back there. That came from Helen Potter, and she asked me to make it. So I copied 25 of them, put them on that table. If you'd like to know better how to pray about this upcoming election. Pastor Mark mentioned that we really need to pray for Tayshaun. Tayshaun is in a place right now. It's kind of like Pine Rest, and it's really a difficult situation. He's going to try to go see him Saturday. He's only allowed 1 hour of visit per week, and it's on a Saturday. Isn't that sad? We don't know exactly what's going on, but be praying for Tayshaun, will you? And Kathy Jones is having surgery on October 2nd. It's still...
That's changed.
What's it going through now?
The doctor called and said that some of her numbers were low on the last blood count. They want to push it back, so now they're looking at October 30th.
The 30th?
Yeah.
Okay. October 30th. Let's keep praying for her that these numbers can get caught up. My ear surgery, September 25th. Thank you for praying for me about that. Are there any other prayer requests? Yes, go ahead, Dave.
I have a praise. My grandson, Jackson.
Yes, I was going to ask about it.
They removed the feeding tube, and so now he's drinking a bottle as long as he can keep it in and get the volume up a little bit. He should be going home probably early next week.
So he is still in NICU up there?
Yeah, he still is in NICU, but he should be going home next week if he can continue eating.
Let's keep praying for Jackson McGarvey. Wow. Poor little guy. He's really been through it, I'll tell you. Let's keep praying for him. Yes, April. This is Aiden Curtis, right?
Yes.
Aiden Curtis is this young man. He's 15, 16 years of age, 10th grader, having heart problems. And I thought I read somewhere in there they might even be calling it cardiomyopathy.
It's a form of cardiomyopathy.
Wow.
It's a genetic.
Pretty young to have. Something he was born with that just showed up.
Yeah.
All right. Be praying for Aiden. Thank you for sharing that with us. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the wonderful blessings that you've given us, Lord. We thank you for the many years that Janice Alt was faithful serving in our church and being here, and her husband Art for years with her behind that. Lord, we're going to miss her, and we just pray for her family that you will give them comfort of the Holy Spirit and help them as this day of her memorial service approaches. I pray, Father, for Barb Mabee, Lord. She's not out of the woods with these problems of fluid buildup in her body, but she does seem to be better. When I saw her Friday, she seems to be getting better. I pray you would help her to get home soon, Lord. Lord, we have some urgent unspokens, and we just ask that you would answer, and according to your will, bless each of these as hands that were raised. I pray for Pastor Richard Yates down in Florida. Thank you that he's doing well. Lord, I thank you for the building project that we're going to be able to see the erection of the steel this week. Bless that, Lord, please. And we just so look forward to having this done. I pray for Renee Fox, Evangelist Byron Fox's dear wife. Thank you that there's been a turn for the good, for the better. Help her, Lord, to get out of the sickbed, please. I pray for Israel, Lord. Your word tells us. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. And we do love Israel. We just pray for her. We pray like David, like Paul did, Lord, for her salvation, individual salvation, Lord. I pray for our country. Lord, I pray that you would not give us what our country deserves at this election, but be merciful to us, Father, please, and help us. I pray for Tayshawn, Lord. He's going through a lot. Please help Tayshawn. I pray for Kathy Jones, Lord, that you would help her numbers, her blood work to be in the right place so that when she does have her other knee surgery on October 30th, that everything will go well. I pray for Jackson McGarvey, Lord, and thank you that things seem to be going in a right direction. I pray there won't be any setbacks. Help this little baby, Lord. I pray that he could come home soon. I pray for this young man, Aiden Curtis, still in the hospital over in Ann Arbor. I pray that he could come home soon, Lord. Help them, give the doctors wisdom. Please touch him in healing. And Lord, I do pray for my upcoming cochlear implant surgery, that it'll all go well. Thank you that Brother Brown could be with us today. Bless him as he shares with us this morning. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on up, Brother Brown. I know your guitar hasn't arrived. You're going to have to use that in the morning service, but we're so glad you're here. God bless you, brother.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I said to somebody this morning that my first team it would be this morning. I don't have COVID. So if I cough, it's just my sinus that's acting up. already you have heard me cough somewhat there, but I trust it will happen while I'm preaching or while I'm singing. So, but the Lord has been good. this year has really been somewhat of a challenge, but God never changes. He's still in control of everything. You know, thank God for the churches that he has given me a chance to be a part of. Right now I'm helping out with a little church in Jamaica still. I don't remember, I mentioned that the last time I was here, but the Lord has given us a chance to be leading that church, and we're praying that God will help us to see grow. Of course, we are in the building program now, so we ask for your prayers concerning that. in April, I don't know if I had mentioned Pastor Tyson before, but in April I had a heart attack, which was very frightening. Very frightening, but the Lord spared me through it, you know, and so right now I'm supposed to be taking it easy. Of course, it slows me down. I'm supposed to be taking it easy, and everybody who called me said, make sure you take some rest, because they know that I'm not the person who always take rest. I'm always going, having a million and one things to do. But I'm forced now to take some rest. Of course, you know, you can't just lay every day not doing anything, man. Life will be boring just like that. So I have to keep active. All right, but I thank God for the rest. And I have some pictures that I would like to show you before I enter into that. Maybe I'll show it again in the morning service, but I'm just going to ask my friend in the song booth there to just show the slides for me, so that you can see, you know, some of what we're doing. And
thank you, Mark.
Okay. All right, should I just go and talk until they're ready?
Sure.
So that's just a picture of what the ministry is like in Jamaica. Of course, the Abundant Life Baptist Bible Chapel is a new church that I am giving oversight to. My son David helps me out. As a matter of fact, I pray for him. He's preaching there this morning while another preacher is covering for me at Nightingale Grove. But Abundant Life Baptist Church is very strategically positioned in that area. It's a very good area that it's at. A lot of people are around. So I just pray that the Lord will help us to reach those people for his kingdom. We are in the building program, as you can see. Of course, you know that everything in Jamaica is made out of concrete. so we just yesterday, I was sent a picture of the roof being sealed. So there, I think they should finish that by now. And the floor needs to be cast so that, we can move in there. As a matter of fact, my intention was to move inside of the building by the end of this year. Because right now we are meeting in a storefront. So that building that we are constructing there is where the church will be permanently. And we want to, get out of the storefront because it's quite expensive. Each month we have to find money to pay the rent. So if we get out of there, then that money that we use to pay rent will, put towards the building. But we have to cast the floor first because the pipes for the electricity is run on the floor, all around. So we can't bring people in there yet until that is finished. So we are praying that the Lord will provide at least $10,000 to cast that floor because we need about 4 inches of concrete on it so that we can trample on it and so. Of course, the platform is is cast already. But even, you know, though there's no windows or doors and so on, at least we have a roof so we can meet inside of a service. So pray for us, and if the Lord bids you, just partner with us, come on board. And of course, I know that, you know, building is expensive because I see your beautiful edifice being drawn in the foyer there, and your building too. So we need to pray for each other concerning that, because it's tight everywhere, man. I know that. Inside the way. As I mentioned to you, this past April I had a heart attack. Didn't even know it was a heart attack. But I was quite fine before that. And I just felt my chest start to burn me and tightened and hurt. And I was weak and I started sweating profusely and those things. So I called my son and he took me to the doctor. So he wrote a message, a letter. After he had done his test, he wrote a letter, Mark. Urgent, and sent me to the hospital, so they need to do a blood test immediately and so on. Well, that was evening, so they did the blood test and all the tests that they had to do and so on, and they just wrote a prescription, give me. But by the time I went to the pharmacy in that area, this, all the pharmacies were closed, so everybody was gone home, so they sent me home. On my way home, my doctor called my wife and asked how things were going. And she told them that we're on our way home, and he got real livid. So I said, wait, this must be something serious. So he asked my wife to give me two of her, you know, aspirins. Because she has a little baby aspirin, so I took two of them. And I went home and I slept and felt quite well, you know. Then, you know, he said I should go back to a doctor in the morning. So I went back to the doctor, and the doctor did another test again. I wrote a letter, Mark, urgent, zoops, straight to the hospital. And I said, you mean I'm going to be in a hospital? I don't want to go to any hospital. So I spent 8 days in the hospital. They were monitoring me and so on. So thank the Lord, I'm getting better. You know, I'm getting better. So just continue to pray for us that everything will go well and that I'll be obedient to the doctor's orders. Because sometimes some of us men don't like to be confined or don't like to obey. So we're forced. Of course, I'm forced now to slow down and take some rest. I can't even preach as hard as I used to, because if I do it, I'll be sort of, you know, straining my structure, and I have to take it easy. Well, he said after 6 months then I can start resuming my normal activities. All right, so pray for us. No, that was a frightening wake-up call. Frightening. And I didn't know it was a heart attack until I was ready to get out of the hospital. One of the doctors came to me with all the documents and said, did they tell you that you had a heart attack? I said, no, heart attack. Otherwise, they didn't tell me that before. You know. Of course, they were saying that it was what is called angina. You know? But the test shows that it's a heart attack. So, you know, and I had a wake-up call because, well, I said, Lord, if this is the way you're going to take me out of this world, I'm prepared, but I'm not quite ready. I'm prepared, but I'm not quite ready because I need to get a house built to put my wife in, because the house we're now living in is the church house. And can I die and leave my wife outside? That was a sword thrust through my heart. So immediately I started working on getting a house. And so we are in the process now of, you know, getting out of the foundation. And so I just pray that the Lord will provide the funds to do that, because it's not a pretty picture, you know, to be sick, can't function anymore. And then, you know, another pastor has to come in, so you know they're gonna need the house. So where am I gonna go? Or if I die, where's my family going to go? So I have to take care of that. So pray that the Lord will provide. We need $250,000 to construct that house there, because things are very expensive in Jamaica. Very expensive to use, and we have to use a lot of rebars, a lot of rebars, because of the code. Building code demands that, and of course, you know that where we are building, it's very rocky, so we have to do a lot of digging and so on. But God is able, isn't he?
Yeah.
God is able, so I'm not worrying as far as that's concerned, but you know, I want to make sure that I secure my family before I go to heaven, even though they may go before me. Yeah, we don't know, but I have to do what the man is supposed to do, all right? Okay, so I will make a little bit of time for a question, and if not, I'll just go share a few things from the Word of God. Is there any question? Brother Jordan, that you saw on the picture there, he went home to be with the Lord just about 3 months ago. A godly man, a blessed man. I missed him so much. He and Brother MacDonald, the two senior deacons that we had, the Lord called them home. And just pray for men in Jamaica. Pray that men will rise up to take their place. That's at Nightingale Grove Baptist Church, that is. At Abundant Life Baptist Church, we have a few men. You know, just pray that they remain faithful and that we continue to reach people for God. Because it's all about God. Yes.
That's a question. How is the community responding to your church in Jamaica? What is the religious background of the community in Jamaica?
Jamaica is largely Christianity. A lot of people, you know, they are conscious, God conscious. But even though they don't trust Jesus Christ as their Savior, they show much respect for the church. And they're quite receptive, you know. So we don't have a problem as far as that is concerned. Yes, was that a question from the back?
I'm just curious about the location of Nightingale Baptist Church and the new church plant. How far away are
about they? About half an hour. Oh,
okay.
Yeah, half an hour. Yes.
How does the government respond to the church? Are there any restrictions from the government, or is it free?
No, as a matter of fact, the government is always calling upon the church to pray. Always. It's amazing, and yet they won't come out of their corrupt ways. A lot of corruption, but they still see the importance of the church. Because when they're in a tight spot, you know, they ask the church to pray. You know, and as a matter of fact, they even encourage us to go into the schools to have devotions. And the schools will always call us to have devotions. You know, so that's a blessing. And we take advantage of that as long as, you know, it's available. We do not know what will happen later on, but you know, you can go into any school. As a matter of fact, they don't have to call you. You just go there one morning and say, good morning, I would like to share devotion this morning. And if the time allows, they would say, no problem. They're glad when we do that. You know, so people are very conscious of the importance of God in their lives, but they just won't make a decision to follow the Lord. I don't know why they, and you know, if anything happens to them, they are calling upon God. So they are using God as convenience, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's pray that God will change that. Yeah. Any other question? Yes, sir.
Is there a drug problem there?
Drug?
Yeah, is that prevalent there, or is it worse here than the men? It seems bad here, but is it a bad problem there? Like, is it hard to reach people because they're on drugs, or?
It's not really hard to reach. I don't see a lot of people roaming the streets because of drugs. To see some, but not on a large scale. Marijuana is used heavily in Jamaica. As a matter of fact, the government has decriminalized marijuana. Not legalized it, but decriminalized it, because if you have beyond a certain amount, you're allowed 2 ounces of marijuana on the street. If you have more than that, then you can be charged. You'll be given a ticket. However, and also, each family in Jamaica, each family is allowed 5 plants. So, you know, people make fun of me with that. They say, Rev, government free your money, can plant some ganja on the hill there. And they will always be making fun of that, you know, but that's how it is in Jamaica. So each person has, you know, you can plant 5 trees. but drugs, it's, well, we have drug dealers, and of course, when you come to Jamaica, in certain places, there's some huge construction going on. Houses, beautiful houses. You don't think that anybody could work that amount of money to build up that so quickly. So, but the government is cracking down on some of them, though. You know? The people just, you know, sell it, build up their houses, and so on and so forth. And you know that those are because of drugs. Because so many people don't have any job. Another thing that is rampant in Jamaica, and I hope none of you will experience it, is scamming. Scamming, are you familiar with that? The lotto scamming, lottery scamming? It's big. Big in Jamaica. You may just hear one day somebody pick up their phone and calling you and they engage in an argument and telling you that you won so and so. If you didn't buy a ticket, you have won anything. So don't let them tell you. That's all. And the younger guys are involved in that. And you know, we just have to pray. It's a scourge in Jamaica. Of course, you know that it's all over the world because it's big in Nigeria, and all over the world, in South America and so on. But you know, don't be fooled, gentle people. Don't be fooled. You know, now I am disadvantaged in somewhat because of that. Because sometimes I'll pick up my phone and call United States here, call some folks United States. If they don't recognize the number, they don't answer. Because they think that it's either a telemarketer or a scammer. You understand? So sometimes when I call, I leave a message or I send a text that it is I who is calling, and they encourage you to do that. So we have that problem. Yeah. All right. Any other question? No? How much more time do I have? It's almost 15 after 10.
Just 20 after.
Okay. Oh, we close 20 after?
20 after.
Okay. Well, we probably just have to take some more questions then because we don't have much time to get into the word. Yes.
How big is Jamaica?
How big? Jamaica is 4,411 square miles. With a population of approximately 3 million people. The parish that I live in, I was just checking it on the social media and Google. The parish that I live in, it's about 150,000 people. The little community that we live in is it's not on record. So I called somebody in Jamaica. I texted somebody in Jamaica recently and asked them to send me, because they have to do it, you know, they are the ones doing the census and those things. Tell me the population. What's the population like in New Market, the area that I live? And, so I'm waiting on that. Because they have, even if you go to the statistics department in Jamaica, it's hard to find that. They'll have the parish, but they don't have the various communities or villages listed. So, unless we're gonna do a census for ourselves, and that's what I'm thinking of doing when I go back to Jamaica, to just start doing a census for myself, you know. Yes.
Is the crime rate high?
Crime?
Yeah.
Yes. It's high, but it's concentrated. It's not everywhere in Jamaica. I know. The news, the media will make it look like it's the entire Jamaica. And so much so that they encourage people not to come to Jamaica as tourists. And if you go to, if you come as tourists, be careful of some places that you go. Well, that's not bad. But it is quite safe in Jamaica. You know, it's quite safe in Jamaica. Yes.
I'm curious. It sounds like the community is quite open to the church, and you're even able to get into schools.
Yes.
Which is very good. But are there any specific groups that oppose the church? Like in America, you might have atheists or Satanist groups. The LGBTQ often is opposed to Christian teaching from the Bible. So there are groups in America that are opposed to Christian teachings, Bible churches. Does that occur in Jamaica?
Well, there are those who are opposed to Christianity and the teaching of the scriptures, but they do not voice it. So we don't have a problem with that. So the LGBTQ in Jamaica, of course, it's illegal in Jamaica. Homosexuality is illegal in Jamaica. All right. Of course, there are homosexuals in Jamaica, and they're not as blatant as it is in the United States, because I understand that folks are, they are almost forcing you to accept their lifestyle. Well, I don't know how they come to that, but in Jamaica, it's at least no, it's not so, because that's dangerous. In Jamaica, it's dangerous. If you are a homosexual in Jamaica, you tread cautiously, because people just don't accept that. All right? So if you are, keep it to yourself. And well, we preach the word. We preach the word. Let the chips fall where it may. We just preach the word. You know, I'll be not afraid to do that. Yeah, not afraid to do that. Yes.
Are there Christian schools in Jamaica, or is it mostly just public education?
Most of it is public education. You have private schools, but not necessarily Christian schools. Public schools. Their churches probably would operate a kindergarten school. Like Nightingale Grove, where I pastor, we have a little kindergarten school there. And Christian principles are taught to the children. But it's mostly public schools in Jamaica. Well, there is one Christian school in a church, in Jamaica, two of our Baptist churches in Jamaica, in Kingston, they operate a school which they are doing very well, even, you know, better than the other schools in Kingston. Emmanuel Academy from Emmanuel Baptist Church and Quest Preparatory at Haven Hill Baptist Church. They're doing very well. Of course, those are two of our bigger churches. Thanks very much. It's now almost 20 minutes after. So thank you very much for the time. Sorry I didn't get into the word, but I'll try to do justice when I come back.
Amen.
Thank you for the wonderful questions. I know that was a blessing. You know, Brother Brown's going to be in the States until October. April, I just had a thought. Maybe it might be a good connection. Maybe have him as a chapel speaker sometime in the next month. I don't know if you'd be up to that or not, but
next month
that she teaches at Algoma Christian, and they could maybe use it. I know they probably have them all decided on, but you know, maybe something to look into. I noticed that in one of your slides they had North Point Christian, a group from North Point.
Yeah, every 4
that's
years
that's where Isaac graduated from.
Oh, we know that school they come well to Jamaica, so.
Yeah, so glad to hear that. Looking forward to hearing him preach at the morning service and sing. And let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, thank you. Thank you for the work Brother Brown is doing there. not only at Nightingale Grove Baptist Church, Lord, but this other church that's down in this Bible Baptist Chapel down in Santa Cruz. Thank you for the work that's going there, the baptisms that have happened, Lord, the salvations. And I thank you for his desire. Thank you for his family as well as their doing. And we know, Lord, that it's such a blessing to have a family member serving in the ministry with him. And I thank you for that. Just bless now the service to come. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.